We have some terrific questions on these yellow sheets. My strategy is to work on some of these questions. There are a few themes that sort of come out. I may amalgamate a few of these questions together. I'll try to quickly look at some of the ones that have just come in. I looked at some of these last night. And we'll deal with a few of these, and then open it up for some more questions from the floor in terms of things that you want to chew on a bit. I'm hoping we can address a little better the response that to this question about publication and resources that Diane was asking. I might see if one of my colleagues from InterVarsity Press might be willing to speak on that down the road, because it's an incredibly important question. So we'll try to take some of these questions that have come in, and then we'll open it up to you. So be ready. And the goal in this panel has been, over the years, we've done these panels several years, not necessarily every year, but often we have, and it's trying to pull the threads of the conference together, to try to cross-fertilize a bit in terms of the different themes that have come out, and also try to look ahead a bit beyond where we are now to the future, as we were beginning to go in the presentation I made, and then in the questions and comments that were made were so helpful. One of the ones that we'll start with, and Professor Sané can join us when he can, which I found very interesting, several people raised it on these cards, which is, again, about the orientation that we have shared here has been within the structures and understandings of evangelical theology, and we've understood that those, even that very category of evangelical is not uniform, but nevertheless, there is a certain kind of cohesion around our evangelical category. Many in this setting sort of gravitate around what I call Lausanne evangelicalism. The Lausanne movement has been an orienting kind of force within that. But recognizing where we are and some of the complexity even in defining that, the question several people are raising is, I'll just quote this way of putting it, how can evangelical global perspectives engage Catholic and Eastern Orthodox perspectives, which are also part of global Christianity? So we have circumscribed our discussions a bit in terms of its Protestantism and also even its evangelicalism. There is a wider world in the Catholic and Orthodox worlds. And so from the perspective of where we sit, what about that broader conversation in global Christianity? I'm just going to look down the aisle and see who wants to begin to answer along those lines.
If I may start. When I lived in the States, I was a member of the American Society of Missiology. And the missiologists there are Catholic, conciliar Protestant, evangelical Protestants, and Pentecostals. And sometimes when we sit at the table and talk there, you know, you don't know who is who, because the common interest is mission. And I have found that having mission as a basis for dialogue, we may be able to go over some of the divisions and suspicions that we have historically conditioned.
Yes, I think one of the things we have to remember is that a lot of the Christian world didn't go through the 16th century. The 16th century has formed Western Christianity. It's deeply Marxist on both sides of that line that ran across Europe, dividing Northern Europe from Southern Europe, dividing vernacular Christianity from Latin Christianity. Interesting, by the way, to see how that line follows the line of the old Roman Empire, perhaps between the people who thought that unity was the most important constituent in Christian reality, and those who thought that the vernacular appropriation of the gospel was the most important. That's by the way, but I think we have to realize that many of the ways that we have of categorizing the Christian world come from a particular period of essentially the experience of Europe and of the descendants of Europe. And many of the descriptors will be, I think, of less and less use as descriptors. Even now, we've got used to thinking that there's Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox. That no longer characterizes the constitution of the Christian world. An awful lot of African Christianity doesn't fit into any of those boxes. Those boxes have come out of European experience. They're still important associationally. I work in an institution that's called Presbyterian, that's where the parent body is Presbyterian Church of Ghana. It's only Presbyterian by accident. It's Presbyterian because the Lutheran Pietist German missionaries who were the key to it were all locked up or deported during the First World War. And Caesar decided that the United Free Church of Scotland should take over the mission. It's now in the World Alliance of Reformed Churches, which I think would surprise many of the people who lay at its beginning. And that's fine. It's an associational thing. But in so much of the world, whether you're a Methodist or a Presbyterian, depends which side of the river you live on. It's nothing to do with the conditions which brought all our divisions into being. And while these associations will continue, I think we are going to find other traditions. I think there's an African tradition of Christianity that's coming into being that comes out of a common experience of African Christians who belong associationally to all sorts of things, but who share a good deal of common experience and the experience of how the Christian gospel has penetrated and changing those experiences.
Yeah, another question that has come up in these lovely cards, which most of which I can actually read, but those that I can read are particularly lovely, is here's one, I'll just put it this way. This is directed at you, Dr. Sané, but others if you wanted to chime in on this. It goes like this: with the rise of Christianity to remarkable levels in many majority world countries, how do Christians there, who make up the majority of the population in those places, wrestle with the questions of political power? Is the accepted stereotype of Constantinian an appropriate way for majority world Christians to think about the power the church is gaining in the majority world, or is a renewed understanding of a healthy Christendom necessary?
Whoa.
Small question, that.
Yeah. The reality is, I don't talk, I find it a little bit of a tongue twister to talk about majority world or two-thirds world, because the idea of the third world, when it was first introduced by French sociologist Le Tiers-Monde, was not a statistical description. It was merely a way of indicating that there was another world, a reality, outside the West and the Soviet empires. And the third world was became economic, and then gradually it became social, and now politically correct to speak of majority world. So I'm not really, I like to, as an historian, I like to go to original intent of the term. The third world is not the inheritor of the Western political legacy in a faithful way. So the idea of Constantine and Christendom is almost completely foreign to most of Africa, let us say. One exception maybe be South Africa, and to some extent, Ethiopia. Coptic Egypt, as you know, the Copts in Egypt have always been on the margins of power. Bishoy, the Coptic bishop, was telling me just a couple of years ago that that explains the survival of Coptic Christianity in Egypt on the Muslim pressure. So I don't think that is really the issue. I think the issue for African Christianity is how do you accept the almost anachronism of the dogma of the nation state, national boundary as definitive of human identity, a kind of secular fundamentalism. How do you negotiate that alongside another category which is far more fundamental and true of your experience on an everyday basis, which is divine sovereignty? So there are sort of two sovereignties, as it were, political sovereignty and divine sovereignty. And I would say for most Africans, their status as believers resonates far more deeply and far more profoundly than their status as citizens. Citizenship is almost an abstract concept for most Africans, whereas to be a believer, it is something that strikes home very, very close, very deep. And so the challenge for African theology has been to try to make the category of faith an operative category for daily life and for looking at the world in an environment where the institutions of society are really geared to supporting national structures and national citizenship and carrying a passport. For us in America, a passport is a big deal, right? It defines who we are. But America is an immigrant nation. And I bet you, behind those passports, especially of newly Americanized citizens, there are profound centers of loyalty that the idea of the passport doesn't really cover. So I would say the challenge for us in America is, does being a Christian amount to something more than being an American? And to cast it in historical terms, is the process of the Americanization of Christianity more important than the process of the Christianization of America?
This is a question. We'll stay with Africa as the context of this, directed at Professors Walls and Sene. We hear a lot about violent clashes between Christians and Muslims in Africa. What do you see happening in the interaction between Muslims and Christians in the next decade or beyond?
Okay. I was going to defer to Andrew on this question. The clash between Christians and Muslims in Africa, I guess, is confined more to Nigeria than it is anywhere else. Senegal is 80-90% Muslim, but Senegal has a very open religious policy, so open that Senegal is one of two maybe Muslim countries in the world that recognizes Christian Catholic holidays as national holidays. So here is a Muslim country that celebrates the Feast of the Assumption of the Virgin Mary. August, it's a national holiday. All the embassies are closed around the world. And Senegal also celebrates the Feast of Pentecost. And I remember arriving one Sunday, Pentecost Sunday, and I said, well, tomorrow I can go to the shops and buy some provisions for my hotel room. And they said to me, oh, the shops are closed because it's a holiday. I said, why? Well, it's Pentecost Sunday, don't you know? And the next question was, but you have that in America, don't you? And I said, no, we don't have Pentecost as a national holiday in America. Oh, they said to me, what's wrong with you guys? So Nigeria is fairly unique in having this rather bitter, violent clash, or clashes really, between Christians and Muslims. And one reason for that is, I think, Nigeria has a legacy of an Islamic theocracy from the 19th century, which was pretty powerful. And the effects of that religious revolution in Nigeria have really made it difficult for Muslims to conceive of Islam in non-theocratic or non-political categories. The Yoruba of southern Nigeria, who have a very strong Muslim presence, I think 40-50% of Yoruba are Muslim, do not, on the other hand, have that violent experience of relations with Muslims. In the Yoruba town of Ogbomosho, which is a great Baptist center, by the way, Ogbomosho is a huge Yoruba urban center. I was told by my host, who is a professor in the theological seminary there, that the chief of the town, which is mostly Baptist, it's a Protestant town, the chief is a Muslim. And next to his palace is a mosque in a Christian town.
And a church.
And a church, yes. Andrew.
Yes, I'm sure this is right. The Nigerian situation is special. It's the Nigerian situation of which we hear most, with a situation, by the way, one of the things we have to remember, I think, is the greatest factor for the spread of Islam was the colonial period. More people became Muslims through the through colonial policy than all the jihads produced. And Nigeria is one of the principal fields where this became the case. There is also, in the place we hear most of, the Jose area, very special local factors which give rise to this. In general, one of the things I think we should think of and pray about is the possibility of opening up a new set of conversations between Christians and Muslims in Africa, simply because of that more relaxed relationship that Professor Sane has been talking about in so many of the places. I think of a good friend of mine, his ordination service, and the immense pride there of his uncle who'd brought him up, a major figure in the Muslim community. His pride in his boy having become a man of God and recognized as a Christian leader. In so many parts of the continent, that sort of conversation is possible without the baggage of the long the long history of relations between European Christendom and the Dar al-Islam, who were their nearest neighbors. We have a situation where Muslims, generally speaking, have not heard the gospel. They've heard our voices. The trouble is they think they know what we're saying. They can't hear because of the baggage of history. I think there are parts of the world, Africa is one of them. I suspect, though, I know it's not for me to speak, I suspect that Indonesia is another. There is the fact that the dialogue first began in India. Parts of the world where the conversation can start without that baggage, and where I think we should be hoping, praying, and watching to see it develop.
Just a word about not especially Africa, but yesterday, as I heard the presentations from Africa, and as we mentioned wars, and I was reminded of a book by Miroslav Volf with the title Exclusion and Embrace. During the 60s, the 70s, liberation became a key word. And I think that for the years to come, embrace and exclusion will be very important terms because they have to do with identity. And it also shows that savage wars don't take place only in Africa, but in Europe also, in Europe in our time. And that we need to reflect theologically about that. And that is what Miroslav does. He's a Croat, and he's now a professor in Yale or?
Yeah.
Yale.
Terrific book. I would commend that to you. Question for all three of you on the panel. It comes through in a couple of different ways here. I'll reframe it, which is to take up the discussion of the mediation between West and non-West, this idea of a ecumenism of Africa, Asia, Latin America, for each of you to talk about the prospects, possibilities, opportunities, hazards of that dialogue. I was pointing toward that in my paper a bit. I'd be glad for all three of you to comment on your perspectives on that. What do you see of the future of that?
Well, somebody's got to start. Let's start with the New Testament and with the New Testament model of the church, which from that very early period from of which I was speaking in my paper, from that very early period was bicultural. Look at the Epistle to the Ephesians, and we see something of what the apostle is expecting to happen. Here, we tend to think of the middle wall of partition being broken down between races, which it is. But remember that also this is breaking down between cultures, and what you had in the early church was these two different Christian lifestyles, two different ways of following Jesus, two patterns of life which clashed in the world outside. The Christian church is of its nature multicultural. That's why we are called Christians. That's why we needed a name. Because there was no precedent for this biracial, bicultural community meeting in meeting together and eating together. It wasn't easy. Lots of Jerusalem Christians seem to have found the idea very difficult. Surely these people are coming into Israel. Surely they should be circumcised. Surely they should. They are proselytes, after all. No, they're not proselytes. They are converts. They are turning. Their way of life has to be turned, just as the Jewish way of life had to be turned towards Jesus as Messiah. So Hellenistic social, family, intellectual life had to be turned towards Christ. Neither of these lifestyles was complete in itself. Those bits of converted social reality were necessary to each other. And Ephesians shows this is not two churches. This is one church. The two are necessary to each other because it goes on, there is a new temple in the Spirit being made. The old temple, some of these Christians, the old temple is crucial at the heart of things for them. Others of them, it means nothing because they're not allowed in. But there's a new temple being made in which both are parts. And you can't do without either of those bits of converted social reality. In Christian history, time after time, we've lost that opportunity. And again, I argued that we had that crucial disappointment in the 6th century when the church split along cultural and linguistic lines. The very defiance of what the New Testament church is about. Now, a whole set of circumstances in the merciful provision of God makes it possible for a union, for an interaction of the old, of the New Testament sort. And one of the things which is making it possible, it seems to me, is this great reverse migration of which I spoke. Now we have the challenge not only of expressing our membership of the body of Christ across the world, but of expressing it locally, of finding in our towns, in this country more than any other country in the world, you have in the United States pretty well every Christian discourse under heaven. There's even a fellowship of Somali churches, which you haven't got in Somalia. There's all this opportunity to express the body of Christ locally. Nobody else is going to do it, and if the church, which is the body of Christ, can't express that sort of humanity, how can we expect the world? How can we expect the state? How can we expect cities to represent it? Here we have the challenge of just being the body of Christ and an opportunity to do it, which is clearer than it's ever been since the first century. I've talked long enough, so I'll leave other people to say how that should be done.
Translation is a problem for that. We have an international fellowship of evangelical mission theologians. And we have people from Africa, from Asia, from Latin America, and from Eastern Europe. But our sessions, our time together, has to be done in English. That's part of life. And also we have books in Spanish that are efforts to theologize, but we cannot have a global dialogue unless they are translated into English. And let me say here a word for Orbis Press that belongs to the Merignol Order. I think it was part of their missionary thrust. The Merignol Order is one of the progressive Catholic missionary orders. They, they realized that something was going on in liberation theology and that needed to be put in English. And they did. The book of Gutierrez was published only 2 years after it appeared in Spanish. It was already in English, and then a flow of theological works that made it possible for people, not only in the States, but also in other English speaking countries, to use it. We have a small effort to translate what we are doing in Latin America. to English, it is costly and it demands work, but it is necessary. We have this Journal of Latin American Theology, which appears twice a year, and you will find there some of the things. This, for instance, is a special issue on immigration, with articles about immigration in the United States, immigration in other parts of the world, immigration in Spain, and a Christian approach to it. So in the process of globalization, translation in a different way becomes a very important element.
It's important to remember what is new and different about this world Christian movement today. Europe was evangelized largely as a result of the creation and the establishment of monasteries. Monasteries were very, very important for the conversion of Northern Europe and also Eastern parts of Europe. And along with monasteries, of course, when the whole tradition of, you know, creating manuscripts, translation, transmission of knowledge and learning through monks, the monastic life became constitutive of European identity in a way that was far more formative for Europe than it was for maybe other parts of the world. But today, monasteries and the monastic life, when I say today, I mean from the 19th century in Africa and Asia, the monastic life, the monastic institution played no role whatsoever in the evangelization and the Christianization of the world, right? Very, very little. And instead, it was really the Protestant movement in the late 18th century which transformed Catholic missions from the medieval mold of church, state, and society to what? And here I would say that America, in that sense, was the last frontier. America was the last frontier. And when we hear of new religious groups coming into America, and so when you will say, we in America, I have to say, what do you mean, we in America? You mean Asian Americans? You mean Hispanic Americans? Growing by leaps and bounds. See, America itself, as an idea, has been made complex by immigration flows. So that here at Wheaton, what you regard as America is very different from how the immigrant communities in their churches and congregations regard as America, including the testimony, a moving testimony I had of a Hispanic woman who came to America, I think as a charismatic Pentecostal Christian, and her reflections on what it means to be in America, to be a Christian, and to challenge Americans to expand the notion of belonging, inclusion, from a kind of narrow chauvinistic national category to one that is faith-derived and faith-based and faith-driven, I found memorable. I can never forget that. And I think that's really what I implied in a very inarticulate way about the Christianized process of the Christianization of America rather than the Americanization of Christianity. The domestication of Christianity in America is being reversed by the immigration flows that are creating the question of Christian identity. Now, let me be a little bit more concrete in terms of the structures we need, monasteries and monastic institutions. I'm not going to mediate between heartland Christianity of the West and frontier Christianity that is out there. This frontier Christianity began on the margins, right, of the Christian world. Today, those margins are becoming the strongholds of the faith. And they, wow, you say to yourself, but first century Christianity was like that. It was very much on the margins of the world at the time, on the margins of society. Jesus outside the city gate and look at how that minority, that marginal community, transformed the world. Completely transformed the world. Without the structures of power that Islam assumes goes with religion, Christians had no power. And they maintained their identity, especially after the collapse of the Roman Empire, by textual or scriptural faithfulness. They didn't have the Roman Empire to look after them. The Roman Empire was gone. How did they maintain these communities? Well, through the reading of the Psalms, through prayer, through worship, with priests and monks. And the village pastor was very much a vernacular figure for both Catholic Europe and Protestant Europe. So I would say we need new structures now for this new ecumenical movement that is really a movement from the margins, from the frontiers, at which America is itself now the new center. And the way I've developed this is the reason why medieval missions, partly why they failed totally in Africa, except in a few places where the exceptions proved the rule, was because they worked with the idea of mission of Christianity from the top down. Convert the king, the prince, the ruler, and the rest of society will follow. The New World ideas, which were revolutionary, innovative, and subversive of the old medieval model, came from the United States. It was in the United States that you had the first mass movement of populations into Christianity who were not European. And those were the blacks, and called them Africans in the New World. The first time that ever happened. And that completely changed the religious landscape. And they became the agents of mission in Africa and elsewhere. And they changed the medieval conception of mission from a top-down approach to a bottom-up approach. We the people. We the people, no longer the prince or the ruler or the aristocrat. America did away with the idea of pedigree in a very small space of time, more quickly than anywhere else in the world. And so Christianity then created a new kinship, a new family, a new society based on communion in the blood of Christ. And it seems to me that America holds the key, America holds the key to what happens in the resurgence of world Christianity. Not because, I'm not talking of the old America, I mean these new groups that are coming into America, the diaspora communities, that are now rapidly being socialized and integrated into America, they hold the key, the clue, to the new global community that is inevitable. It's going to be here anyway, and we need a Christian language to read that new reality. And let me just conclude by saying that Christianity pioneered the most pervasive intercultural, cross-cultural movement in history, in the sense that more Christians pray and worship in more languages in the world than any other religion. On any given Sunday, there are Christians praying from the scriptures, reading the scriptures, worshiping, singing hymns in more languages than any other religion in the world. So that Christianity, if you like, has catechized the world into the language of pluralism, diversity. And all of that is held together, if it's held together at all, by faithfulness to the scriptural witness to God who was in Christ, reconciling the world. And that, for me, is the key, is the clue, is the theological center of what we should see writ large around the world. And the old divisions, I agree with Andrew, the old divisions of Catholic, Protestant, and Orthodox don't make any sense whatsoever in this kind of world. And America here, I think, you should know that, because in America, freedom of religion has allowed a great diversity and vitality of religion to occur, to take place.
Thank you to all three. We can open up now to some questions from the floor for one or all of our panelists. David.
David. From the first day, I wanted to ask a question to Mr. Walls. Because you had some, I would say, pastoral and prophetic words for the first world.
I'm terribly sorry, I'm not.
It's hard for us, are you in the sound booth, hard for us up here to hear from those mics.
Uh-oh.
I don't know what you can do about that.
Okay. What I said is that...
Let me come forward.
Okay. What I said is that from the first day after I listened to your presentation, I wanted to ask you this question, because it seems like you have a pastoral and a prophetic word for the north of the world. I would like to listen some pastoral and prophetic voice from you for the South, because, of course, we need a lot to do there too. So, what do you see?
A prophetic
word. Oh.
No, it's for. Thank you. It's not for me to act the prophet. However, I think the crucial thing for all of us is to be faithful. To be faithful to Christ and his word. And I don't think one can really get beyond that basic word. One thing which the experience of the last century has taught us is that there is no birthright Christianity. There is no inevitable, no permanent churches. No single Christian culture, no special Christian history. Larmin has taught us that Christians have no Mecca, no central permanent point, no Arabia that you think of as constituting the heart and representing the heart of our faith. And remember that once the Yemen was a Christian kingdom, even in Arabia. There's no permanency. Our New Jerusalem comes down ready-made out of heaven at the last time. We've no central point. Christian history has been serial in the expansion of the faith, not progressive. Christian history hasn't been an inevitable triumphal march. Our hymns and some of our sermons speak of it in those ways. But it's not what happened. It's a history of advance and recession, of moving forward, moving back, and of moving in different directions, so that at different times, different parts of the world have received the duty of leadership. And at different times that duty has passed, sometimes very suddenly, to other people. Think of the words in Revelation to the churches, where as the Lord looks at their present work and witness in this very early period of the Christian faith, he says to some of them, if you don't change, I will take your lampstand out of its place. Not the Muslims will take it. Not the pagan state will take it. I will take it. I won't have any further use for you. Think of that mother church of us all, the church of the apostles and elders of Jerusalem. Think of all the time and effort that the Lord spent on those first apostles. Think of that wonderful church with that wonderful symbiosis of gospel and culture that comes into being as a result. But how long does it last? A couple of generations. And then suddenly, overnight, as it were, with the collapse of the Jewish state, the model church, the mother church of us all, just disappears from view. Who has to take up the responsibility? Those pretty raw, pretty new Gentile Christians in Antioch and beyond. The sort of people who got 1 Corinthians. Can't you imagine some good, upright, law-keeping, conservative Jewish believer, Jerusalem believer, reading 1 Corinthians and saying, "Told you so. These people need the Torah. They've got to have a framework." A couple of generations and they have to lead the church. And time and again that's happened. Here we've had an unusually long period. I argued before that the last 500 years have been exceptional in having such a regional concentration of the Christian faith. That crucial time around 1500, when Europe became more Christian than it had ever been before, and at the same time Christianity became more European than it had ever been before. And this period of several centuries when Europeans become the representative Christians. That was an unusually long time as far as Christian history goes. We've seen in my lifetime the end of that period. And it's passed on to someone else. Now, this may not be a very good answer for the prophetic word, except I think the prophetic word is there in the letters to the churches. Here is where leadership has to come from. The Christianity of the 21st century is going to be judged by what happens among the Christians of Africa, Asia, Latin America. We have, for reasons I think we were talking of in relation to the last question, special new opportunities that are coming out of the dispersion of Christians, that now African, Asian, and Latin American Christianity isn't only in Africa, Asia, and Latin America, but in other parts of the world too. Having said that, we're all together in this. We are all parts of church of Christ's body. But the baton is passing over. This is where responsibility will lie. That's the best I can do.
Well, I would have a word that would be more on the pastoral side. I would say to my brothers and sisters outside of the Western world that they need theologians that can reflect about their experience, not as angry prophets, but as pastors who encourage what is being done well and at the same time build up so that things can be done better. And for this, it is necessary to recover the memory, the historical memory, as well as the biblical memory.
I have only a brief word to say on that, which is that I think one of the most important things for theologians of the South is that they must love their people. I say that because of my awareness that theology has become an academic discipline, and it's very easy for theologians to talk to themselves and among themselves, and to become professionalized in that way. the most important challenge, as I see it, for theologians from the South and other religious scholars, such as myself, is never to forget that faith must not be cut off from life and from experience, and that our reflection as scholars of religion must always have the tangible context of lived life and experience, and that our fundamental loyalty, therefore, is to our people rather than to our professional colleagues in the annual meetings to which we belong. This is a special responsibility for theologians and scholars of the South, special, that we must play the game of the guild and our loyalty to our colleagues, very important, but our fundamental loyalty is to our people, to whom we belong.
That strikes me as a beautiful note upon which to end. Shall we thank our panelists?